can our housing finance system be reformed in order to better serve communities of color? By 2050, if not before, we will be a majority-minority country, and the fate and the opportunities of communities of color will have a direct impact on our national economy and financial security. We cannot leave these communities behind. So our goal is to really make sure that we have solutions that work for everybody, and in today's panel and really in this whole session, make sure that those solutions are really going to work for communities of color. As you heard on the morning panel and through a lot of the question and answer dialogue with the Secretary Geithner, those opportunities have not always been equally available to all of our families. And a lot of that has had to do with the way the system is structured. And so this, for better or for worse, provides us a really unique opportunity to take a step back and say, while we're refiguring the jigsaw puzzle, let's make sure that it works for everybody.
Removing all federal backstops in the mortgage market is not really even a serious question out there. I mean, it's the question we receive, but it's framing the debate in the wrong way. No one really believes we could go back. If we took out all federal intervention, we wouldn't be reverting to 1999. We would be reverting back to 1929. And the way I like to say this is that this rhetoric of wishing that we had a private sector housing market is a nostalgia for a past that we have not had since 1934. So really, until 2000 through 2007, we haven't really had a private sector mortgage market. And the one experience we've had since 1934 was the Alt-A, no documentation, liar loans, and subprime, which were done through private label securities. And that experiment was an utter disaster for the world, for the U.S. economy, and for those borrowers who got stuck in all of those loans. So the question about federal involvement is really one, I think, of honesty, of trying to figure out where does it come in. So if we take away a Fannie or Freddie, for instance, what we're basically doing is transferring those assets that they were holding into another sector, and a large portion of that will go to federally insured bank depositories. So we've never, and when people say, I want to go back to the private sector lending that we had before this last run-up, they're often confusing bank lending as being private sector, when the banks are, in essence, the true GSEs. They have private shareholders with a public purpose and with the public guaranteeing all of their liabilities, all of the deposits. And so even when we go back into the 90s and say, well, at least then Fannie, Freddie, and FHA had only 70% of the market, the remaining 25 to 30% was not truly private funded. It was private in that it was being done by federally insured institutions. So what I find most aggravating in this debate is that it's just dishonest. There's this notion that, well, let's play out rhetoric of private sector, but we, in 1934, instituted federal deposit insurance, because we were having runs on banks. We instituted FHA, the Federal Home Loan Banks, and Fannie Mae. So we said at that point, in order to stabilize the economy and not have booms and busts up and down, we're going to have a backstop of federal involvement. Now, that doesn't mean we can't figure out ways to bring the private sector in. The two places that private sector have taken on risk, and they're very simple to do, is to say, let's lower the loan limits on some of the entities that are playing. So instead of 700,000, we could go back to 417,000, or in falling home prices, we could go lower. Or we could say, let's have private mortgage insurance or some other risk-taking requirement as part of the process.
First of all, let me say I totally agree with everything Martin has said so far. I think what's important to recognize about this whole issue about depositories versus Fannie and Freddie is both of them have government backing. Both of them are part of a system that wouldn't exist but for the government context within which they operate, including the regulatory context. That doesn't necessarily make either one bad. It doesn't necessarily make either one good either, but I just think that we've got to be pretty clear about that. I wanted to bring a couple of other ideas into this. First of all, Mark Mayall, before he left, was the only person who put tax policy on the table. And I think when we talk about when we talk about a federal role in housing, if we don't put tax policy on the table, if we don't recognize that we have a huge subsidy going to the top of the market, above and beyond any subsidy that's caused by the high loan limits, then we're having dishonest conversation. And there've been lots of proposals to turn the deduction into a partial credit and all kinds of things like that. But I think it is foolish to not bring that into the conversation. Foolish for this community to not bring that into the conversation, because frankly, that's where the money will be to, among other things, support better rental housing and down payment assistance or anything else. And I really hope we get into the down payment conversation, because I actually have something to say about that too. But the second thing I wanted to talk about is something that I suspect that people in this room probably aren't as familiar with, so I really want to bring it up. You know, one of the cries about why we have to get rid of a government guarantee and why we can't have a catastrophic guarantee backing up private equity is that the government can't price the risk, that the government can't price insurance risk. And there certainly are some circumstances in which the government has done a truly lousy job. Crop insurance, flood insurance, and the Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation probably sort of stand out there. Those are all situations in which Congress basically sets the premiums. Okay, so what's the alternative? The alternative is the establishment of a system that includes an on-budget reserve fund that sets parameters and has the premium be able to be administratively set. Now, the FDIC, which came close to running into trouble when Congress set its premium, in fact, has come through an enormously difficult situation because it's been able to react. And I think the Secretary's statement this morning about the 25 basis points for FHA, even though, you know, he's going to have to get permission for that, is also a good indication that when we've got somebody watching the store, when we've got a basically robust structure in place, you can, in fact, the government can get close. And then I would say, okay, so guys, what's the alternative? Because the private sector certainly did a truly miserable job of pricing risk, right? They got it completely wrong. And we picked up all the pieces anyway. And housing is a big enough part of this economy so that I'm not ready to believe we wouldn't pick them up again. So my feeling about this is, come on, let's get real. Let's understand that one of the problems that we've had with Fannie and Freddie was that there was a guarantee that was not priced, that was not explicit, and let's work at that and get it done.
I think one thing we all need to kind of take a step back is that once we, you know, and I've worked in Washington for a long time, once Congress has acted, you kind of forget what they did and you're on to the next issue. I think in this discussion, we're at the very beginning of housing finance secondary market reform. And that reform is going to take place in the framework that was just created by the Dodd-Frank Act. And that's a very strong law that a lot of people in this room worked on that is just now starting to take shape in the mortgage area. And right now, the qualified residential mortgage definition is under debate among the regulators. And that's going to define what kind of mortgages can be securitized and who has to retain the 5% risk or some portion of that. And that's going to change the types of loans that are securitized in the future and will help determine how a private label securities market comes back. And that's going to be very, very important. The second definition is the qualified mortgage definition, which is the consumer-facing definition, which includes what it, where lenders will have to determine there's limits on the types of loans that can be offered. So a lot of the problems that everyone in this room was concerned about, inappropriate products going to borrowers, there's a lot of safeguards in there in terms of no more balloon payments, prepayment fees are limited, there's a duty of care for originators. In addition, it wasn't part of Dodd-Frank, but there was a law passed called the SAFE Act, which now requires licensing for mortgage brokers and registration for originators. So there's going to be much more oversight over individuals originating loans. So hopefully a lot of the problems that Martin, you know, identified over the last several years that they were very concerned about in terms of, you know, bad origination practices, a lot of that is addressed in Dodd-Frank. So going into the secondary market reform discussion, we have to keep all that in mind, and it's still taking shape. On Janice's question about what's the role of the federal government, I agree with Martin and Ellen, is that you can't say that there's not going to be any role for the federal government. I know that there are some lawmakers, some, you know, analysts, and some, you know, think tank people that are saying we got to minimize the federal role, it's got to completely change. But to have a secondary, a secondary market that provides broad access, particularly to the 30-year fixed-rate mortgage, and that's where we came from. Over the last several years, we had a group of our member companies looking at what should happen after Fannie and Freddie. The key question is, do we want to maintain access to the 30-year fixed-rate mortgage? And if you went to a completely private system, you could have, and Alden knows this as a banker, you could have a mortgage system without that. But, you know, and Martin gave a little of the history, you'd be going back, you know, in the beginning, before the Depression, loans were generally 5-year balloon loans. And when the crash came in the, you know, in 29 to 30, people couldn't refinance. And we had a, you know, somewhat similar problem in this kind of Great Recession that we had. But so, thinking about housing reform, we have to think about, do we want to maintain access to the 30-year fixed rate and other products like that? We think you can do it bringing more private capital and risk-taking back into the system. The government is going to have a role. We think it has to be much clearer on the fact that it's got to be explicit on the MBS that is being created, not on companies. Companies should be able to be allowed to unwind and fail in a clear manner. Part of the problem with Fannie and Freddie was that they were in that gray area. But this is going to unwind over, you know, several years, and I think everyone in this room is going to have a role in defining what the terms are. But I think first is to keep in mind that the new standards in Dodd-Frank, which are just going into effect, are something that are going to influence whatever we do in secondary market. I'll stop there and keep going.